Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming and for watching that unforgettable film. My name is Jacqueline Bhabha, and I'm a member of the South Asia Institute, and with several colleagues, including Professor Rosenfeld on my left and others, we started working on issues of gender-based violence after the December 16th rapes. So we've been thinking about this issue for some time. My role is simply to be chair and moderator. I think we don't have a huge amount of time. We have to be out of here by about 8 o'clock, which is 40 minutes. So what I'm going to do is very briefly introduce the panelists in the order in which I'm then going to invite them to say not more than 5 minutes' worth of comments each. And before I hand the floor to the first panelist, I'll make a few comments myself. So our first panelist is Lakshmi, who is an economist and an associate professor in business, government and international economy here at HBS. She teaches globalization and public policy, and I believe it was her initially idea to that we should screen this movie at Harvard. So, Lakshmi, thank you for that. Our second panelist is immediately on my left, Professor Diane Rosenfeld, who is a lecturer on law and director of the Gender Violence Program at Harvard Law School, and somebody who's spent her whole career thinking about issues of gender violence and justice. And her main experience is in working domestically states, both as a scholar and as an activist, but she also been quite involved in some of our deliberations about India. And then sitting in the middle is my friend and colleague, Beena Sarwar, who is a Pakistani journalist and filmmaker, who's focused on human rights issues, gender, media, and peace for many years. She's currently the Pakistan editor of Aman, Asha, which is an initiative trying to peace between India and Pakistan. Okay, so that's a great panel, and I'm sure we have many very interesting sort of contributions from the floor too. I want to make just a couple of points very quickly before I hand over, first of all, to Lakshmi. My first point is that I think one of the issues that we confront here today, which of course the film doesn't address, is the question of censorship. How is it that the biggest democracy in the world supposedly is censoring a film of this quality and this professionalism about such an important topic? Why is it? How is it and why is it? And I think for those of you who don't know, I would just mention that unfortunately censorship in India is absolutely nothing new. The first anti-censorship law was introduced by the British in 1927, and it's been used many times since then, probably most famously against Salman Rushdie for his book, The Satanic Verses. But it was first used in the 1930s against an American feminist who wrote a book decrying the sexual exploitation of Hindu women, The Face of Mother India, and her book was banned for demeaning and defacing Hinduism. So I think it's interesting that that's a precedent. And many of you might have heard of the banning of our colleague at Chicago, Professor Wendy Doniger's book, which far from decrying sexual brutality, actually celebrates sort of the sexual liberation and sexual diversity of India, and that book was also banned. So this question of banning issues which are unresolved, especially or including when they relate to issues of gender and sexuality, is, I think, a very real issue. Why did the Indian government ban this film? The reason given, apparently, was that the film, quotes, may lead to widespread public outcry and serious law and order problem. So not quite sure what that means, but I think clearly there are debates here which need to take place which are very threatening to the authorities, and I hope some of that will come up in the debate. I just only really want to make, I'm sure my colleagues will make other points, I just want to make a final point, which is about the current political moment. As many of you know, the BJP government has made all sorts of comments about gender and the role of women and shame and decency, which are really not, unfortunately, a million miles away from some of the very extreme comments we heard in this film. The Prime Minister himself has gone on record as saying that India is in the forefront of neuroscience because the whole notion of images like Ganesh, a mixture of animal and human, really indicates that India is in the forefront of plastic surgery and other kind of completely obscurantist and absurd statements, which are not said in jest, they're said truthfully. So I just mention this because I think we're actually up against something much more grave and at the core of certainly Indian and maybe South Asian, maybe global society, than just some, you know, very violent, drunk louts. Anyway, with those comments, let me turn it over to Lakshmi. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I'm really happy to see so many people coming to both to watch the movie and discuss these issues. And I would just highlight a couple of findings from academic research on this topic about gender violence. And I think the movie made a very good point that one very root cause of such events and such violence is attitudes, the mindset, the idea that women can be treated extremely badly, that they are almost talked about as property, right? They belong to a family or a man or a father or somebody like that. That this is a very widespread attitude, treating them as less than a man. And so that's one component of it, of gender violence. But so one thing for thinking about challenging this or changing this culture, one is to change the culture directly, which is quite difficult. It is not easy when it is when such attitudes are very widespread. What I would like to point out are a couple of I would say rays of hope, which some research has pointed out about certain things we can change to enable such changes in mindset. One very important thing is to change the economics of the situation. So India and South Asia in general is pretty remarkable in seeing an extremely low labor force participation rate of women. So I think for the last 20 years, it's been stuck around 30% in urban areas in India, despite the fast growth of the country as a whole and so on, that figure of women participating in the economy has not budged on the aggregate. There's a very nice paper in China written by one of my friends who showed that in the initial stages of the Chinese liberalization, when they liberalized agricultural prices, the places which grew crops where women had an advantage, like tea, saw an immediate change in the gender ratios. So China, as India, you can see a very skewed gender ratio. It's widely used as a proxy to measure gender prejudice. But what her work showed was that within 2 or 3 years of making women's labor very valuable, the attitude or the mindset or the actions changed. So I think it is possible. It, I think, just shows what is possible to change, that these are not mindsets set in stone, even if they have been around for hundreds of years. Sometimes simple things like making the women economically more valuable. And this is what I think some of the movies said about education and giving, empowering them economically can have huge benefits. The second thing I would point out is some research of mine where I was looking at political empowerment of women. So India, as many of you might know, has a one-third quota in village and district level government councils. This is the Panchayati Raj reforms. And we were looking at what happened after the states passed this Panchayati Raj reforms and what happened to crimes against women. And what we saw in our data analysis was a huge increase in crimes against women. But these are the documented, the reported crimes against women. So when we looked at survey evidence and other types of evidence, we could not find any evidence of actual crime going up. I think it was more people are willing to come forward and say, report these crimes to the police. And this is a range of crimes against women, including rape, cruelty by husbands, dowry deaths, all sorts of categories of the Indian Penal Code. And when you look at the survey evidence, it's even very clearer. You see women living in villages with a woman sarpanch or pradhan, the village head, are much more likely to answer yes if you when you ask them the question, if something happened to you, if someone hurt you, would you go to the police? And while compared to the women who are not living in such villages. So there is a fact, there is a change in attitudes of the women who see that they are represented in the official political structure. The more important part, I think, which is more interesting, is you also see a change in how they are treated by the police once they go. So they are much more likely to say that the police actually recorded my complaint, I was not asked for a bribe, the police actually investigated my complaint. And you can even see a huge increase in arrests by the police for crimes against women after the Panchayati Raj comes into place. And this is particularly important, why I'm going back to the mindset idea, is that these village and district level women representatives actually have no formal power over the police. So the police are controlled directly from the state government, the state capital, where on average there are only about 5% women in state government. So despite the fact that there is no formal change in authority, behavior is changing on the ground. So that's what I mean by a ray of hope. It is not the only solution, because in our work, we did not find any evidence of these crimes going down. But it is the first step, at least, that they are coming out into the open and being reported, and people are getting arrested for it. So there is some hope that it'll go in the future. And I'll just end by saying that the second problem with particularly crimes against women is the silence which surrounds it. And that is why the censorship of this movie, I think, is, you know, a censorship in general, I think, is bad. But I think here it is particularly bad, because I don't know which is the bigger problem. The problem is that these events happen, or that there is such widespread silence around issues like domestic violence and other types of demeaning of women. So in that sense, I'm glad we were able to make a tiny step. And I'm very happy to hear about this petition which has been put forward, and I would urge all of you to go sign it.
I think everyone should take a deep breath. I think when that student kind of passed out, I felt like I was about to as well. I am almost speechless about this. I appreciate your comments. There is so much we need to do on so many different levels. I was really privileged to work with Jackie on advising the Verma committee, because they really had a very broad reach, and Gopal Subramaniam had connections to the law school because he's done programs in India, you know, about lawyers, and so I was put in touch with him, and he was so open and so interested, and so he has such a big, fabulous brain. He's such a wonderful person. So we worked on advising and saying, well, here's what works. We also went to Delhi and had a conference in the summer of 13. And we got to meet, I got to meet Laila Sith. And she was so amazing, because we're in a government conference with activists and lawyers and politicians and journalists. And she talked about patriarchy. So I want to talk about patriarchy for a minute. Patriarchy is not inevitable. It is a social system that is undergirded by male-male alliances. And I co-teach a class called Theories of Sexual Coercion with Professor Richard Wrangham, who's in the anthropology department. And he's the one who's taught me a lot about the origins of human sexual violence. And I'll just give you a very quick summary, which is that in almost all primates, there is evidence of how the males will use sexual coercion to coerce and dominate females as reproductive resources. And this is in chimpanzees, will batter their female reproductive partners in exact proportion to how fertile they are. And orangutans will commit rape, and gorillas will commit infanticide of an infant that's not their own, and then abduct the mother and adopt her into his harem. Okay, so this goes on all over primates, except for bonobos. So bonobos, who knows what a bonobo is? Show of hands. Okay, yay. This is the foundation of the bonobo society right here. So bonobos are very remarkable. They're a separate species from chimpanzee, but they're species of chimpanzee, but they're separate. And they grew up on on the other side of the Congo. And what's remarkable about the bonobos is that their social structure is identified through female-female alliances. And if a female bonobo was aggressed upon, she would, by a male, she would let out a special cry, and the other females would descend from the trees and fend off the male and sometimes bite his ear and send him into isolation for a couple days, and then they would reintroduce him into the tribe. Now, what is absolutely remarkable about bonobos is that evolutionarily, they have eliminated male sexual coercion. So they all get along, they have lots of sex, they're happier, they're healthier, they share food, they're peaceful. So they give me hope. And here's one message that we can think about, which is, and we see this a lot in this country, and definitely did not see any evidence of this in the film, for example, but about how women divide against each other. And women divide against each other for male protection. And males get to decide who's a whore, who's worthy of no protection, and who's a wife, who's worthy of only that man's protection. Because like you were saying, that there's this property. And legally, you know, a woman was her husband's property for many, many, many years. And you know, laws change, but attitudes don't change as quickly. But so women divide against themselves for protection, but it's protection against male violence. And I want to see new systems, I want to see new global collaborations and alliances of females to protect ourselves and protect each other. And you really learn this when you take self-defense, which you can all take through HUPD, you learn in your body about your own self-protection, and it really affects your self-esteem, and you learn how strong you are. Even though we're taught that we're not as strong as men, you know, your elbows and your knees and your heels, for example. And once you learn to protect yourself, it makes you much more capable of standing up and protecting your sisters. So I'm founding the Bonobo Principle, which is as follows. One, no one has the right to pimp my sister. Do you all agree with that? Two, everybody's my sister. And I think this kind of structure, restructuring our thinking, might lead to an end to this kind of complicated, ridiculous, widespread, worldwide, in so many different forms, violence against women.
Thank you. Okay, and last, sorry, thank you very much, Diane, for those thoughtful and interesting comments. And lastly, Beena.
Thank you. Thank you all for your very perceptive comments, which I learned a lot from also. And this film, I think, has probably really shaken everybody up. I was kind of asked to speak on the media side. I think a lot of the aspects about gender and the society and the attitudes have been already covered. So about the media, I will say, well, first of all, I totally agree that this kind of thing should not be censored at all. I think that what the media can do is to shine a light on issues that are on the darkness, and that is how you drive away the darkness, is by shining a light. The other thing to think about is that while media do take up, have taken up this issue in a very big way, and you know, one by covering the rape itself, and secondly by covering the protests with so much, in so much detail. But we don't see that kind of, we see that more with urban-based issues, because media tend to be urban-based, middle class. So for example, I'm on a email list of, it's a Dalit Rights Watch, which is, and I get emails from them almost every day listing, you know, crimes against Dalits. And so what happens is, like, for example, in something about this film also reminded me of, how many of you have heard of the case of Mukhtar and Mai, the woman who was gang raped in Mirwala in Pakistan in 2002? I think it was a very famous case of, she was gang raped, she refused to stay silent. She was, I think people like Hillary Clinton and the UN, and she was, you know, went all over the world and spoke. And in 2005, she was not allowed to leave the country. Because the then president, self-proclaimed President General Musharraf, said that, you know, he ordered her to be put on the exit control list, and the authorities confiscated her passport before she was going to come to the States. There was a conference she was going to be speaking at, and nobody knew why suddenly what had happened. And he landed in New Zealand, because it's like almost 24-hour flight. So when he landed there, he was faced by reporters saying, "What happened? Why has she been stopped from traveling?" And he said, "Oh, I did it. I did it." He was very proud of himself, because this is going to be, it is something that is not good for the country. She's defaming the country. This is not going to help the women's cause. So that's the same kind of attitude due to which this film, the Indian government has banned. It goes against the image of India shining. We don't want these attitudes of this lawyer and of this man who's speaking, who's saying that, you know, women's places in the home, and if my daughter went out with a man at that time of the night, I'd burn her. I mean, they're openly saying that. And those are not rare, that lawyer, that clip was from earlier, like soon after the trial. That was an earlier clip. But, at that time, there wasn't that kind of sense of outrage about it. That came up only after this film was banned, because then that whole issue of censorship and what should be shown to the world and what should not be shown came out. So on the one hand, you've got the media, really playing up one side of a story, but then, decontextualizing it in a way, like the ongoing misogyny, the ongoing violence against women, the ongoing, the attitudes that exist are not covered in the same way, because the media tend to cover events and not processes. You don't, you have a situation where you have this really dignified, wonderful family of Jyoti Singh. And I had heard of her because her father's interview had come in a British newspaper, actually, in which he had said, "Give her name. Her name is Jyoti Singh. I want the world to know my daughter died fighting. She was brave. Let her give courage to other people." And they wanted to actually use her name to bring in that law initially. And I'm still mystified why the Indian media, because there's a law in India where according to which the victims of rape cannot be identified by name unless they agree to that, unless their families agreed. So I really don't understand why she's still being called Nirbhaya, which kind of jars on me, because it kind of takes away from her kind of identity in a way, or like the it's a really important thing that, my name is Jyoti Singh. Mukhtaran Mai stood up and said, "I am Mukhtaran Mai." She, if you try to hide behind pseudonyms, it kind of takes away from the issue. Although in this case, Nirbhaya has become a symbol for the certain issue. So I think those were my main points.
Thank you very much, Beena. Okay, so we have just over 15 minutes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to clump, assuming there's a lot of questions, I'm going to clump them in threes, and please really be considerate and make your question a question which ends with a question mark, and make it short. Thank you. And please just briefly identify yourself. So the floor's open. Yes, go ahead. And do you mind standing up? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Mohit Anand in the MPA program at the Kennedy School. I was actually wondering, so watching the movie, I couldn't help but think that it's highly complex, a lot to take in. And therefore, given how complex the film is, given the complexity of India and all the different attitudes, being an Indian myself, how it could be misinterpreted in so many different ways. And I think we see that. I don't think it's as simple an explanation as saying the government censored it because it's India's image. I think that's one part of it. I don't think it's as simple as saying it's the mindset of the BJP. I think it's much more complex than that. So I was actually wondering, knowing that reality of India, that something like this can be misconstrued, sort of censored altogether, would it have been a better strategy to actually sort of go under the radar, put it out in schools, work with communities, work with governments to actually have it seen broadly, rather than come out with such a bang, get it clamped down by the government? Or perhaps this is better, that this got more attention because it was censored and it made a hue and cry.
Okay, thank you very much. Yep. Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah. Second question.
Hi, Diane, you'd mentioned that...
Yourself, please.
Hi, I'm Becca. I'm a law student here. You'd mentioned that when you had traveled to India to work with the commission that you talked a little bit about what works, and I was curious if you could mention a couple of things of what you would have advised what works.
Thank you. Yeah. Third question? Yeah.
So the question is, so we watch some of the university students that organize a lot of the protests. I'm wondering what is the nature of, it's one incident, but there's so many things that happen every day, especially with Dalit and poor women. What's the ongoing sort of grassroots mobilizing, organizing? Has it built new alliances, new coalitions, organizations, especially amongst young people?
Okay, great. So we have the first three questions. One about, you know, the strategy of the film. The second one about what works, and then thirdly about sort of grassroots mobilization. So would each of you like to pick one?
I'll just address the one about the media, about the censoring. Yeah. I think that's a good point. It is a complex film. But I think to say that a documentary filmmaker isn't making a film in order to make it with a bang and get it banned. That was not the intention of the film. It's an issue that's very complex. It's a very deep, it's a very disturbing issue. I'm sure this was not an easy film to make. I'm sure the intention was not to either shame India or to, I'm sure it was not ulterior motives. You have, it's a very, I think a very compassionate film, and it brings in a very important point also about poverty and about development and about the unbridled, quote-unquote development that is breaking down family structures, social structures, and letting people literally wild and loose. So you're kind of going back to the primate sort of thing, I guess, in a way, sort of like concrete.
Okay.
Jungles, so.
Thanks, Beena. Yeah, Diane, what works?
I'll give a quick answer. When this happened in India, the Steubenville case was breaking in the United States too. So, and it had happened a few months before, but the media attention was increasing about it, and it really made just so clear that gang rape by males of a female is not so aberrant as we would really like to think, that this is happening, and we have so many problems in the U.S. So as Jackie said, I do focus more on the U.S. One of the successful things that we've been working on is on using Title IX to stop campus sexual assault, and to really articulate student civil rights on campus to a sexually hostile-free environment for their education. So working on laws like that from a civil rights perspective can be helpful. And there's a film that will be screened called The Hunting Ground on April 22nd at the Ed School that I would urge you to see.
Thanks very much, Jan. Yeah, Lakshmi, do you want to take the last question about what's happening on the ground?
I don't know of any major organized event which is happening nationwide on the ground. I think it was a very strong positive sign to see the kind of protests we saw. Because I remember even at that time somebody was saying, what is going on in India? I said, this is the best thing which could have happened. Not that I wanted this rape to happen, but it was quite unprecedented to see the level of outrage this incident generated. And it's not that these incidents have not been happening. The outrage was new, and I think that is a good thing. So even the protests we saw on the screen were not coordinated by any very well-organized group. It was a bunch of lots of people coming out, and lots of groups are working on it. It was very spontaneous. So even now there are lots of groups which are working in their own ways. I don't know of any big nationwide coordinated effort.
Thank you. If I could just add to that a couple of points. Firstly, I think that next week the Radcliffe Institute is organizing a large conference on violence, a large part of it which is on gender, and they are bringing as part of that Flavia Agnes, who's one of the leading feminist activists, advocates, and so she would be an excellent person to ask this question to. She's actually going to be in Cambridge next week on Thursday and Friday, so anybody who's interested, I would really suggest you quickly register for the conference, because I think it's going to be quite well attended, and maybe try and ask Flavia. The second point I'd make really relates to your point about reporting, and that I think that one thing that really has happened, at least from the perspective of a person who spends a lot of time in India also looking at newspapers, is this shift from shame to outrage. That women are and families are supporting their daughters in reporting and not sort of hiding behind the shame of it and the ignominy of it, but rather saying this is outrageous. And so you have seen this spike in reporting of crimes. And I think that's a very dramatic change. And then thirdly, of course, as a result of the Verma Committee that Diane mentioned, there has been legislative change, there have been new rules instituted, and there have been certain processes to speed up trials and so on. So there have been a lot of changes. At the grassroots level, I think, you know, there's been a lot of activity, but I don't think there's one big united front. I think people are, as usual, kind of have different positions and different perspectives on how best to mobilize. Okay, let's take the next. Yeah,
I just want to make one very quick point about attitudes, which is, you know, in India, he's saying that she shouldn't be out with a man who's not her husband. A lot of people said that, and we used to have that in Pakistan also. That attitude is all across South Asia. But in the West also, when violence against women takes place, the first questions you hear are, what was she wearing? Why was she out at that time? Why was she there? Who was she? You know, that kind of thing. So this is a global. I think one of the reasons this film is so important is because it speaks to a global universal issue. It's not just, and I wrote an article last week called Not Just India's Daughter. This is not just India's daughter. This is about women around the world.
Thanks, Beena. Okay, next round. Yeah. Lady with the yellow t-shirt. Yeah. Oh, actually, I was going to ask her to speak first. Sorry. Yeah, go ahead.
I had a question.
Could you introduce yourself, please?
I'm sorry, Charlene. I'm a former employee at Harvard. Mm-hmm. My question is concerning the conviction of the juvenile, considering that he was almost 18 years old, and in the U.S. he probably would have been tried as an adult, and to only have a sentence of 3 years, what do you guys think was the reasoning behind not trying him as an adult and as a juvenile?
Thank you, yeah. Second question, the lady who had the mic before, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I just
could you introduce yourself?
Yeah, sorry, Naomi, I'm a medical student, not in the law school, but I completely rely on what you say, that it's not about Indian daughter. I thought that was very interesting, and especially in the movie, they were also saying that it's about society, and I completely rely on that. Actually, traveling in Brazil or Mexico, you heard exactly the same comments towards the poor community, right? And you're very surprised about the gap in terms of mind and consideration of women between the educated society and the people who, well, live under the level of poverty, all those things. So there is a huge gap that you might find somehow know everywhere. So I was wondering if there is some statistical tools or things like that to measure how much the correlation between rape and sexual assault and the education of people.
Thank you, yeah. Third question? Yeah, go ahead.
I'm Ming from the education school. I do very much agree with I think that was the Supreme Court Justice who mentioned education might be the only solution to a lot of these societal problems. And I would wish to see more about what education system's reaction was to this, or how is gender currently taught in school or not taught?
Okay, great. So answers. I actually quite like to take the juvenile question. The juvenile. Okay, well, maybe I'll just respond briefly to your question about the juveniles. So there was a lot of outrage, you're absolutely right, about that sentence and about the fact that this boy was tried as a juvenile. In brackets, there was a lot of outrage generally, and this kind of baying for the blood and for, you know, the death penalty is actually, as one of the interviewees said, it's not normal in India. I mean, it really does show the kind of ferocity of the reaction. And different people have had very different responses to this sentence. Personally, as somebody who works on children's rights, I completely endorse it. I think it was the right thing to do. He was a juvenile. Indian juvenile law makes it very clear that somebody should not spend more than a certain amount of time. Now, whether the tariff is right or wrong, I'm not sure, but I have no doubt that putting a child or a young person in an adult jail for extremely long periods of time, as we do in this country, is not in the best interest of the development of that person or of the society. So personally, I support the fact that there is separate mechanisms for juvenile justice. It may be that in certain situations, you know, as I say, the tariff was misaligned given the gravity of the crime. But even there, I'm not sure. Would anybody like? So the second question was about. Okay, yeah. Oh, the social class of offenders.
Well, I just want to say something about that, which is that, you know, they actually come from pretty much similar social classes. They're both basically village people. The offenders as well as the victims are people from villages who've moved to the city. They're new migrants. They're migrants to the city. And the Jyoti's family is not very educated either. But the lawyers are. They've been to law school. So, you know, I don't know if education, it's not just education, it's about the kind of education, it's about mindsets, it's about, you know, the lawyer saying, I'll burn my daughter in front of the whole family if she goes out with a man. So I don't know if that's as simple as that.
Yeah. No, I completely agree. And just to give a personal example, not on crimes against women, but on attitudes towards caste. There's a similar story. People of lower caste are often treated as lesser people, and many offenses are committed against them, and so on. And you could see that education alone is not the answer. So when my sister, for instance, wanted to marry a man of a lower caste, you should have seen the outrage on my side of the family among certain members. Very educated, high caste members. They were, you know, college educated, teaching in colleges, and yet they could not get over the idea that somebody in their family is going to marry somebody of a different caste. My grandmother, who basically had studied until I think the fifth grade or something, had no problem with it. So it's a completely inverse correlation. She was the one I expected to be most outraged, the most traditional, the oldest member. She was there, she was dancing at the wedding. So I think that education might help only if it's a certain kind of education, but I think in terms of what determines mindset, it is something like social norms, what you think is acceptable. And the way you can change, and you can change this a little bit at a time. So I think personally, it's helpful to be very conscious of sometimes unconscious biases we have. So at the Harvard Business School, right, we've been doing a lot of thinking about gender and about the fact that for many years, the women students were not doing as well in the classroom as the male students. And the question was why. And part of the reason, after a lot of analysis, was, well, it's a very participant-based system of teaching. We use the case method. And generally, men are much more aggressive about speaking up, and especially in front of a crowd like this. And so a valuable lesson as a professor, which they said, was if you ask a question, don't just pick on the first hand which comes up. Give 5 seconds. Okay, I'm not saying wait forever. Give 5 seconds to enable the women to speak up and raise their hands. And I found that such a simple thing helps. And so I think it was more a point of being conscious about your own actions in things you may not have realized that you are unconsciously making it difficult for the women to speak up. But in most cases, especially in South Asia, it's much more overt. But I think in our own little way to be conscious and speak up for women or speak against others who are putting down a woman in a particular situation, I think every little bit helps.
I just want to add to the caste business bit over there, which is that Jyoti was out with a man, a friend of hers, with her parents' knowledge, she had gone to a movie. And I've read reports about this where they said, no, she would never have married him because he's from another caste. You know, and this is something that doesn't come up in the film because I think she's dead. Nobody wants to rake that up. And her father also, her parents also said in an interview, no, she wasn't serious about him. There was no question of him. They were just friends. But, you know, I don't know. It's just that caste issue is very, very, and it's not just India. It's all across South Asia. In the Mukhtar Mai case, she was raped by men of an upper caste, slightly higher caste, but then she was coming up in her, you know, her family was becoming, you know, better and they had slipped down. In the case of Asia Bibi, the woman who's in the death cell for so-called blasphemy, she's from the lowest caste, you know, a Dalit, you know, the converts, and the woman who accused her of blasphemy is from an upper caste and they were working in the same field and the woman felt she'd been, you know, there's a lot of very subtle issues around that.
We actually have an extension of 10 minutes, so if we can just take a couple more questions.
Yep. So my understanding is that a majority of sexual violence and rape happens by people who are known to you, as opposed to somebody completely. So that adds another level of complexity, and I wonder to what extent that can then be mitigated and what the strategy should look like.
Thank you. Yeah, that's for you.
Hi, I have a niece who went to India. She traveled all over the world. And when she went to India, she was attacked by a group of pilgrims, religious people wearing orange robes. And they chased her and assaulted her. And then she ran to the police. And she said the police treated her worse than the attackers. And I'd like to see some clarification from this gentleman, because in our country, JFK, our president, wrote a book entitled Profiles in Courage. And I think it's very important, if you'll forgive the gender-biased characterization of the alpha males, whether they're in America or in India, they need to set the right tone and take responsibility, even if it might get them assassinated. It's very important that they lead their nations. And I'd like to give the microphone to the gentleman here to...
Sure, perhaps. Thanks. Okay, but we'll do that. It's the second question, so he'll take his turn. Yeah, third question. Yeah. And could people please introduce themselves?
Hi, I'm Arijit. I'm from the physics department here. So my question is there... So a lot of these crimes are getting public attention because they are sort of committed in urban spaces, and this is sort of the migration of the crimes from the rural to the urban, these kinds of sort of gory violence. Mm-hmm. I mean, is there a way from the point of view of urban planning to create spaces which are more sort of more helpful in sort of encouraging behavior which is better towards women?
Thank you. Okay, so Dan, first question.
Thank you. How did you know I wanted to take the first question? I have recently developed a term that I call target rape. And it's about the idea that it came from working on a case where this guy, before he went out and raped this woman, so he was a fraternity member in the US, in Arizona, and he posted on Facebook a picture of a young, thin, white woman with long hair lying on the ground with a tank top and jeans, and her ankles and wrists were bound with computer wire. And he put this on his Facebook, and he had 1,700 people who could have accessed his Facebook account that night, and then he went out and then he raped this young woman who he also very seriously injured her. It was a horrific event. He did it with like kind of the help of his fraternity brothers. And I was talking to the lawyer about it, and I said, you know, we need new terms, because it wasn't stranger rape, and it wasn't date rape, and it wasn't really acquaintance rape, because the acquaintance was just made for the purpose of grooming her, making her more vulnerable through alcohol and drugs. You know, it's really target rape, and calling it target rape takes the attention away from the victim-offender relationship that seems to blind everyone around the world to sexual violence. Like, oh, they were dating. Oh, they knew each other. Oh, well, then she was lying, or we don't really know what happened because it's he said, she said, and we know that that always works out to he said rules. So this is just a different way of thinking about it and conceptualizing it, and I'm hoping that that will seems to have some traction.
I would also point out one further thing. Because of this fact, legally sometimes you can have measures which backfire. So if you have very, very strong penalties for rape, what happens if the rapist is known to the person, especially if they're a member of the family, it can paradoxically discourage mm-hmm. reporting. Mm-hmm. And so we have to be, it really does make the issue very complex.
I just want to say a couple of things. You know, so you said something about protecting, or somebody said something about protecting men, protecting women and all that. I came across two visual ads recently. In one is Indian and one is from Afghanistan. And in the Indian ad, there's a, and it's in a train, and there's a man sort of looking sort of lecherously. And then there's a fellow standing, and he notices that the man's gaze is going to a woman who's sitting in, like, on her phone, and her neckline's plunging a little bit, and this guy is, like, lasciviously eyeing her. And so this fellow, the other fellow, kind of just takes one step forward, and he blocks the fellow from looking at her. That's one. And the second one has a woman walking, a young woman walking, obviously a student, she's carrying books, and she's walking by, and two young men just walk behind her, walk very fast. She gets nervous. They overtake her, and they come in front of her, and she stops, and they start menacingly come towards her, and another man who's passing by comes there, and he stops, and he looks at them, and he goes and stands in between them. And they're like, get out of the way. And there are two of them and one of him. And then another man comes, a Sikh fellow. And they get interfaith they've got. So the Sikh fellow comes, a Muslim fellow comes, and a Christian fellow comes, and they all hold hands, and they create a barrier around the girl. And I liked, I mean, it was nice, it was good. But I was like, okay, so it's the men who are protecting the women. And something about those ads, I was like, how could the message be put forward in such a way that it's not just about protection, but about maybe empowerment, or about the person who is engaged in the aggression, him being stopped in some other way. I mean, why does it have to be a man who comes? And then the question of mothers is just the relationships. It's not just a woman. She's somebody's sister. There's another ad in Pakistan that I saw where these guys go and start teasing a girl, and she's nearly in tears, and she turns around, and one of them is his sister. And so they leave her alone, and they all, you know, get very embarrassed, and they run off. And I'm like, yes, but what if she wasn't his sister? So that's one thing. And the other thing about the, somebody asked a question about when you have the community and the honor and, you know, the violence within the family and all that. So across South Asia, not just South Asia, across, you saw this in Latin America also, you have this in the old Greek society also, in Spain, everywhere. The sort of honor, the crime of passion, and it's somebody who knows the victim. It's usually a lover or a husband or a boyfriend or whatever. And then you have, in our part of the world, it's like, that honor thing that, you know, she's our woman, my community, my family, I will punish her. And the Taliban have taken that to an extreme by attacking women who are not part of that, you know, who are not their community, a woman who's a teacher or a hairdresser or something, and they think that she's being immoral. So this kind of vigilante thing, and that's the mentality of this guy. And he was like, she was with a man who wasn't her husband. How that justifies it. So there's this vigilante sort of thing that counters that moral thing about women protection.
Thanks. Okay, yeah, gentleman over there. So what about examples?
So I didn't quite understand. Do you want me to?
Why should the leader of India not act like the gentleman in the book entitled Profiles in Courage? Why should he not take the alpha male role in making things right and making the change, even if it means going against great odds and great opposition? Or how is he misunderstood? Because I don't...
The leader of our prime minister? Well,
yeah, he has a duty.
Yeah, he absolutely does. And I think part of the problem is that he doesn't understand that to be part of his duty, because he's operating within the same patriarchal, misogynistic framework that we've learned pervades society so deeply in India. And I think that responsibility, I mean, A, he's not, even if he comes out and makes a statement like that, it's not going to change. And I think that responsibility doesn't lie with him. It lies with everyone in India. It lies with different dimensions of what we have in India, whether it's education, whether it's sexual education, and not just literacy, I mean real education, opening people's minds, asking them to think about how they deal with the opposite gender, how they deal with each other as men, as women. It deals with police reform. It deals with just socioeconomic empowerment of women. And I mean, that's immensely complex. And I think just one leader, I mean, it would be amazing if our prime minister stands up and makes that statement, so that at least it gives some kind of a direction and a signal and at least a notional comfort that at least the supreme leader of the country believes in something like that. But he doesn't stand up for it. I don't think you can expect him to, but
thanks,
I think it needs to be.
Yeah, thank you. I think we're going to end this conversation. You can have it offline. So the last question was about space and the relationship between gender violence and planning. I don't know if anybody in the panel would like to just say something about that.
Gender violence and what?
Planning or space. around cities in ways that maybe, I think that was your question, reduce the risk of violence?
Yeah, so, I mean, transportation is a huge thing. The idea of protection and safe spaces is really, really important. The way that this manifests in the US, for example, in campus sexual assault, is that when males have control of the space, they ally in committing rapes. And they know when they, like in fraternities, for example, they have control of the social space and they know where the rooms are, and females who come to those parties are very badly disadvantaged. So starting from there, like schools in the US should supply safe spaces and equal spaces that are not male dominated. And urban cities, you know, urban planning can do the same thing that just don't have dominated by males spaces, but I'm not really sure what that looks like yet.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you all for your excellent questions and contributions. Thank you to the organizers for this evening's event. Thank you to filmmakers, and Anisha has very cleverly pulled up the Radcliffe conference details just to encourage you to look at them in case you're interested in carrying forward this conversation. Thanks very much indeed.